Most of the times you see me here, I try to tell you some cool story that gets you interested in physics. But sometimes the physics is the story. This is definitely the case with light. Light is just amazing, and I think it's kind of obvious. You're experiencing me through light. You experience your smartphone through light, your beloved smartphone. You experience the world around you through light. Light is a really mysterious thing. Even though we experience it all the time, it's hard to actually describe it scientifically. But that's exactly what we're going to do. We're going to think about light as a wave and learn to think really carefully about just what it is. Well, let's get this thing started by reviewing our lesson objectives. First, we'll define light. Then we'll examine electric and magnetic fields. And lastly, we'll consider wavelength and amplitude. Light is so cool, we have entire shows just based on it. We manipulate the color and direction of lights to create a dazzling display like this one in Singapore. But what exactly is light? Let's get ready for a scary definition. Light. A varying electromagnetic field. Okay, what in the world does that mean? We're going to slow down and take a close look at electric fields and magnetic fields so we can put them back together and understand what exactly light is. First up, electric fields. If we want to understand what electric fields are, we have to understand the electric force. And it's the force between charged particles. So, for example, positive and negative things attract, and positive and positive things repel each other, as well as negative and negative things repel each other. So there's a force between these things due to their charge. And an electric field is a way to describe the strength of the electric force. So here we have just one charged particle. So there's not actually a force, but if we were to place a charged particle nearby, it would have a force on it. And so those arrows describe that force. It's pointing towards the negative sign there, and that's actually the direction electric fields always point. And the arrows indicate the direction a positive charge would move if I were to place it there. So the arrows indicate the direction a positive charge would move if I were to put it there. Okay, so now you have at least a vague understanding of what electric fields are. If it's not perfect, don't worry, we're going to come back to electric fields in a later unit. So light is an oscillating electromagnetic field. We kind of understand what electric fields are now. Let's zoom in on magnetic fields. Fortunately, magnetic fields are a little bit more straightforward for us because we have everyday experience with them. Magnetic fields are just a way to describe the strength of the magnetic force, which is associated with magnets. So these lead filings are arrayed around our magnet, and they're actually kind of mapping out for us what the magnetic field is doing. Just like the electric field, there is a force that we're describing, the magnetic force, around this magnet. Okay, light is a varying electromagnetic field. Once again, we're looking at this definition. We now kind of understand the electro and magnetic part. There's both an electric field and a magnetic field in light, but the key here is it's varying, and that's what actually makes it a wave. Here we have a water wave, and it's a wave because we have varying water height. Another way to put this varying word that's a little more sciencey is oscillating. So we have oscillating water height. Okay, that's water waves. What's oscillating here? This is light. So what's oscillating is electric and magnetic fields, which sounds pretty abstract. But picture the sun. It is a big old hot ball of plasma, and in it, a bunch of electrons and protons are shaking around. That shaking proton and electron creates a shaking field that extends all the way to your eye and shakes electrons within the rods and cones in your eye. That is insane, but that's what light is. If it still feels a little unclear to you, that's okay. This is a tough topic. But what's oscillating here is electric and magnetic fields. Let's continue to take a close look at that. We can understand these oscillating electric and magnetic fields by considering water waves more closely. When water rises, it carries this surfer with it. This is the same thing that light does, except with electric charges. So when the electric field strength rises in light, a charge, like an electron, would rise with it. And when it falls, the electron would fall with it. This is a representation of what light is. Notice there are two waves kind of overlapping here and perpendicular to each other. So on that red axis, we have the electric field strength oscillating up and down, up and down, up and down. The magnetic field is shown in blue, and it's coming out of the page towards you. So we have a magnetic field and an electric field, both oscillating, and they're perpendicular to each other. I couldn't make this stuff up. It's crazy. Meanwhile, they're all moving in the direction they're pointed on the right. So remember, in light, the electric and magnetic fields are perpendicular to each other. Lots of times, though, we just collapse it into one wave. And here, we're just thinking about the wavelength. It could be for the electric field or the magnetic field. They have the same wavelength. What is the wavelength? Well, it's the distance between two peaks. And in this case, those peaks represent the strongest the electric field or magnetic field ever gets during that wave. So wavelength is just the distance between two peaks and electric field strength or magnetic field strength. What does that determine in our observation of light? Wavelength turns out to determine color. Wavelength determines color. So when we look at a rainbow with red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet, the difference between those different colors is the wavelength. All right, let's go back then for a second to our picture of light. It's moving. And so there are a bunch of peaks moving by us. How many peaks go by in a second is known as the frequency. So on the left, we have a low frequency wave, and on the right, a high frequency wave. Recall that frequency is just how often a peak goes by. And frequency, just like wavelength, determines color. They're kind of two sides of a coin. If I determine frequency, I'm also picking an exact wavelength. And so together, they determine color. When I look at a rainbow of different colors, I know that each color is going to have a specific frequency and a specific wavelength. Let's return to our schematic of light. Remember that light is moving. In this representation, it's moving to the right where we see that little arrow with the word direction by it. And light goes crazy fast. Because of that, peaks pass by really often. So light is really fast. And because of that, light has very high frequencies. How high? Well, green light has a frequency of 5.45 times 10 to the 14 hertz. That number is mind-bogglingly large. Let's translate that number so we can understand it more easily. It's the same as saying 545 trillion peaks per second. So the frequency of light, super high. All right, let's move on to amplitude. What does amplitude mean with respect to light? If you think carefully about our lesson so far, you might be able to answer this. Amplitude, the height of the peak, just tells us about how strong the electric field gets at its maximum, or how strong the magnetic field gets at its maximum. Those are kind of interchangeable. So amplitude is just the maximum strength of the electric field. What does amplitude determine in our experience of light? Well, it determines brightness. So a very bright light has a very high amplitude, a very high peak strength of electric and magnetic field. When I look at this moon, it's very bright, and so the light coming from it has high amplitude. But the stars around it are less bright, and so their amplitude would be lower. All right, let's see if we can put into practice all of those words we've just learned. Identify the word from the lesson that best matches each description. Pause the video and give this a try, and then we'll come back and take a look at the answers. All right, well, let's think about A. Wavelength determines, well, it determines color. In light, this oscillates in strength. So what varies in strength in light? It's the electromagnetic field. It would also be reasonable to say the electric field or the magnetic field, those would also be true. How often a peak passes by? What is that? Well, that's frequency. Amplitude determines, what does amplitude determine in light? It determines brightness. Higher amplitude means a brighter light. E, a way to describe the strength of the electric force. We covered this only briefly at the beginning, but that's what an electric field is. It's a way to describe the strength of the electric force. And so it's the strength of the electric force that oscillates in light. Let's review what we've learned. First, we defined light. We said it's an oscillating wave of electromagnetic fields. So the electric and magnetic fields get stronger and weaker, and that's just what light is. Then we examined electric and magnetic fields so we could make sense of that definition. And lastly, we considered wavelength and amplitude. We saw that wavelength, as well as frequency, determines the color of light, and amplitude determines brightness. Hey, hey.